perspective of African and African American history and phenomena. My name is Kofense Chika, and I have an in-studio guest, Sharon Sexton, with me, who will get a little more into you and what you have to bring to the show in just a few seconds. I just wanted to remind our viewers to tune in, join us. You know, you can view with us. We're streaming live on TV 33 WHPR in Highland Park, Michigan, brought to you by Watkins Broadcasting. You can listen, watch, call in, of course, call in, share your views with us, ask questions, share comments or even perspectives that you have. You can view us at live streaming at TV 33 WHPR, www.tv33WHPR, on the Roku box, Chromecast TV, and in the TV 33 WHPR app, which is available for those with Android devices at the Google Play Store, and for those with Apple devices, you can download the app at the Apple iStore. And I just want to take a moment of silence for those ancestors that preceded us to help to pave the way for us to be here today. And just a moment of silence for them. And I'd like to also mention a very close friend of mine who made his transition today, Curtis Sloan, was actually killed in an automobile accident on the way to work. And we had been friends for over 50 years, and I'm not quite 50 years old, but very hard to do, right? So, and we're gonna do a departure from our normal, the normal way we begin in the show. We normally take a day in the life of African Americans in Detroit from a day on this day on Brother Ken Coleman's book, which is a historical daily account of historical historical events in African American communities in Detroit, because we want to use as much time as we can to talk to and share with our distinguished guests who we have in the studio. And I'd like to just give a little background on our guest, Sharon Elizabeth Sexton, who is a unique multimedia specialist who has combined her television production skills in front of and behind the camera to create exciting, informational, and relevant programming that has been broadcast on commercial television, cable television, and the internet. Ms. Sexton's background as an investigative television reporter, minority affairs and cultural programming, television producer, award-winning film director, print journalist, elementary school teacher, and well-rounded filmmaker have been molded to produce many memorable presentations, whether it be oral, print, video, or broadcast. Ms. Sexton is the creator and creator, producer, director, writer, editor, and talent for a video documentary program entitled The Helen Street Report. This popular program is designed to educate the public about the true history and daily life of the people who live in the city of Detroit. The program has won the Urban Programming Award from the New York International Independent Film and Video Festival in 2006, and the Best Documentary Award for Detroit Windsor International Film Festival in 2008 for her documentary, which we're going to discuss today, Black Bottom in Paradise Valley, The Forgotten Legacy, that expertly pieces together 300 years of Detroit, Michigan history. And what I didn't notice in your bio, and this is my perception of you as a Detroit historian, and what I didn't know as we were on our way into the studio, you brought to my attention that you were also very instrumental in helping to bring the Underground Railroad statue monument, which is right at the foot of Woodward, or just beyond at Hart Plaza, where we see the newly freed Africans, or prospectively freed, formerly enslaved Africans, looking to Canada for freedom. So,
and there is another monument, the sister monument, on the Canadian side,
which
is welcoming the runaways to Canada.
So were these two monuments were done in tandem with each other? Was this part of the same project?
Well, basically, how it started was years ago, when I was really in depth in my research for the Underground Railroad, It was eye-opening. It was, I was so proud of these people, and these were Black people who were instrumental in developing not only an Underground Railroad route through the United States, and we're talking about, they claim to have had 1 million strong, they claim to have had safe houses on plantations. I mean, that's how, you know, brilliant these individuals were, and nobody knew them.
You know,
nobody knew them, and I was just astounded. And when I was doing my research, I'd run to the, because nobody would be around me, so I'd run to the library and say, look at this, look at this, oh my God. And they would say, oh yeah, very interesting. Thought I was probably a little nutty, you know.
I can relate, just having done research on Detroit. I was working on a research project, and when I found out that the Ocean Suite House was actually still there,
standing, right,
on Kercheval and Garland.
Right.
And as I was reading this, when I literally put the book down, got in my car because I had to go see that house so I could relate to that. But what you sound like, even as you talk about it now, you're very animated and excited.
Oh, I am.
But
I
you
really
sound
am.
Like a Black person that grew up in Detroit.
Well, I did. And my father was from Detroit. My grandmother came here, you know, with everybody else with the migration from the South back in the 1920s. So we're third generation in Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
But when I was dealing with this history and realized that there was no monument to these fabulous people, even white folks in Detroit, I had to do something. So basically back in the 1990s, I formed a committee. We called ourselves the International Underground Railroad Collaborative. And we went over to Canada and we got the brothers and sisters with the various Underground Railroad monuments and locations over in Canada. We said, hey, we need to have some kind of recognition here. And so we kind of got together, and thank goodness at that same time, the Detroit 300 Committee was meeting to do the various activities that they did back in 2001.
That was for the tricentennial?
Yeah, the tricentennial. And basically, I submitted, along with Dr. Leach, if you remember Dr. Nathaniel Leach, he was the historian over at Second Baptist Church, and he was my mentor, and he had a doctor's name in front of him, so people took him a lot more seriously than they took me.
Right.
So, you know, I got him, and we went and presented this information to the Detroit 300 Committee, and they accepted it, which was great. And then all of a sudden, because they didn't have another Black project in a Black city, all of a sudden it became this big to-do. And my whole reason for doing this is because when the Underground Railroad was actually taking place, there was no separation between Canada and the United States. You know, the brothers and sisters used the Detroit River both as a vehicle to get runaways away from the United States into Canada. But before that, you know, Canada had slavery too, and there are a lot of people who don't realize that there was slavery not only in Canada but in Detroit.
And the enslaved Africans there came
over here,
right?
So the Detroit River and the Black people here, they did such a phenomenal job that I had to have a monument to their existence.
Well,
we have it.
I'm appreciative of the fact that you have done this, and what I found out.
Oh, but we're not through, so you can be appreciative and help me in my next phase.
Okay, no problem.
But you want to know what the next phase is?
Sure.
To put names on the individual, because the person who is pointing the way.
So
across,
those are actual people.
The one person, the person who is pointing his finger across the river, is a man by the name of George DeBaptiste. We talked about him earlier.
Yes.
And actually, he was a phenomenal individual, as you know. But for the people who are not familiar with him, he not only was a Black man who was part of the Underground Railroad here in Detroit, but he also had a little boat that was docked on the Detroit River, which he used as a means to transport runaways. And so the fact that the monument is near where he docked his boat was very important to me. So.
Wow, how powerful is that? And I think, from the perspective of having done research, I think a lot of times people think about scholars and researchers and it's boring and tedious, but it can be very, very spiritually moving, and you can get excited about different things. And that's what I hear as I hear you talk.
Well, you know, because my background is a reporter.
Okay.
I look at things a little differently than historians.
Okay.
And I can really appreciate the reporters who wrote the stories in the various newspapers from back in the past, because those are the stories I read that got me into the story of the Underground Railroad. And they would report these things with the personalities of the people, mm-hmm. and you can actually imagine all these different things happening. Mm-hmm. And so I not only got a perspective of the history, but also the personalities. Mm-hmm. And they were fabulous personalities. Some of these people were funny. Some they're so daring. You know, George D. Baptiste, since we're talking about him, he was a light-skinned brother, and some white people didn't know he was black. So in one of the books, the directories, he's in the book both as a black man and a white man.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, those are the kind of jokes that he would, you know, portray. And then, Levi, who is the mayor, who is a good friend of theirs, who owned the hotel.
I'm not sure.
Oh, okay. Well, we're going to have to bring you up to speed.
Okay.
I have to come up to speed. I have to get back into my research and get all the names
exactly.
and everything.
Right.
But this one white man, he had a hotel.
Mm-hmm.
And George D. Baptiste, he would go in and he would be in disguise and he would be talking to the slave catchers or the owners who were trying to find their runaways, because mm-hmm. what I found fascinating is during slavery, these slaveholders were really ticked off when their slaves escaped.
Yes.
And they personally wanted to come and get them back.
Right.
So anyhow, he would be in this in the bar, you know, talking to these guys, and they would be, you know, drunk and telling them all their business. And in the meantime, the runaways that they were looking for might have been out in the stable.
Right.
And so, you know, it was just a fascinating read mm-hmm. of these personalities, the tricks that they use, the daring things that they used to do, mm-hmm. you know, like we were talking earlier about the African American mysteries.
Right.
And that was the specific group of black people who operated out of Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the ways in which you joined the organization was that you had to go down south and kidnap a enslaved person without him knowing that you're going to come and bring him back.
Yeah, I think
safely.
I read that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in your research, did you find much information about Henry Bibb? Because I found him to be a very fascinating character. You know, Henry Bibb, he lived here. He lived in Canada.
The newspaper man.
What came out in, I'm not sure if it's a book he wrote, but somewhere I was doing research, is that he was captured. He escaped from slavery, I think, 3 or 4 times. He escaped, came to the North, got captured, sold back into slavery 3 or 4 times. I mean, to me, it really made the 12 years of slave story look, just pale in comparison. But also what came out in the research is that, and you did mention that these relationships, this two-way relationship between Africans in Canada and the Africans on this side of the mm-hmm. river, but how they had mutual aid societies set up. So they had systems and networks of institutions and finances available. So if you escaped to Detroit and made your way to Canada, there were collective communities that would lend you money to buy land, to buy provisions. I mean, we really had some real support network systems in place. And I was just wondering if you may have read or come across information about Henry Bibb. But what I really wanted to get into today, of course, is the documentary.
Oh.
I don't want to get the name right. From Black Bottom in Paradise Valley, The Forgotten Legacy. And in the bio we read, it says you very cleverly pieced together 300 years of history.
Right.
Now, if I remember correctly, earlier in the documentary, you talk about some of the lore around how Black Bottom came to be known as Black Bottom.
Okay,
and
right.
I think there's a reference to a very attractive African-American woman. What was her name?
Anne Marie, I just think it's a
fascinating story.
Okay, Anne Wiley.
Okay.
Okay, basically, well, the whole thing about Black Bottom, people have stories, you know. Now, the story which basically everybody has agreed to as probably the truth was that when the French came to this area and they started chopping down all the trees, the soil was so rich in nutrients that it was black in color. And so they called it Black Bottom. Okay, and basically those are the early farm lands in Detroit, which, if in case you're from Detroit, you want to know where this is basically between downtown Detroit and Belle Isle on the Detroit side along the river. Okay, so those were the farmlands, and when the farms were no longer viable, they cemented the farms, which is so crazy. They cement the best land in the area and start building neighborhoods. And so basically that land was the land that the immigrants came to when they came here. Okay, so you want to get to Nancy Ann Wiley. And we have to go back into history to when the French were here.
Well, why don't we just do it like this? I just remember that as a very fascinating. Why don't you kind of give us a chronological overview of your work? So that way you can start.
Well, let me, before I even do that, basically, I'm a dyslexic person.
Okay.
And for me, in order for me to understand things, my dyslexia is that I have to have things in order.
Okay.
I put things in order. When I was a little kid and my mom gave me M&Ms, I had to put them in their color orders before I could eat them, you know.
Okay.
So I had to put them in order.
All right.
And what I ended up doing, which I hadn't seen anybody else do, was put the history of Detroit in order. So you start off with the French coming here and then the British taking over and then the Americans coming. And then what happens after that, you know, with the... I didn't even realize how much prohibition, you know, played into our history. Mm-hmm. So putting various aspects of history into our storyline. And so basically that's what my documentary is a storyline of Black history. And it really only touches a very surface. It doesn't get really deep into it, because otherwise it would have been a documentary that we'd still be looking at now, because so much details.
Exactly.
But so it just kind of like lightly touches the timeline of Detroit history with us in it.
Okay.
And basically with us as the main characters.
Okay.
So
that sounds like Black history to me.
Yeah. But I don't think a lot of people had really put it in that kind of time order before. So you can understand why we are here, where we are now in Detroit, with this whole division of black and white, because you know, let's face it, Detroit now is what, 85% black, even though white people are continuing to come in and black people are continuing to leave. We still seem to be the very dominant society.
Right.
And then the other two more dominant societies than white people would be the Hispanics and the Middle Eastern people. So we are a city of brown people.
Right.
And folks don't understand, how do we get here? So until you see the entire timeline, then it's like, that makes sense.
Right. Well, it's interesting. You mentioned the Chaldeans, which are a very significant portion of Detroit population. And I remember I grew up in Detroit, and it seemed like somewhere around maybe the early 70s, all these Middle Eastern people start showing up. And it was fascinating to me, because I remember there being Jews and Italians and Polish people, and of course African Americans having businesses in our communities. But what I found out later is that there had been a presence of Chaldeans and other Middle Eastern people in Detroit as far back as the early 1900s. And I didn't know that until I had been introduced to some research to that effect. But go ahead.
Yeah, because I think And I guess I shouldn't say this because I will get in a whole lot of trouble. But I think that there's a reason for that, and that is when the racist people who decided to name the races, basically they said Middle Eastern people were white.
Right, and it's interesting that you say
Indian
that.
Indian people from India are considered white in this
When they came group. To the United States, they had to go into the white category.
Right.
And it's interesting, there was a brother here that taught it in Saroma who was an Egyptian, and this was in the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
But he was, if you didn't hear him talk, you would think he was an African American.
Mm-hmm.
And he actually filed a lawsuit because he had to classify himself as white, and he rejected that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's interesting, and it also speaks to the impact of having power and control in institutions and the ability of these people to use those institutions to sustain their power as it pertains to numbers.
Right.
But let's get back to Black Bottom and Paradise Valley.
Well, let's go. Okay, Black Bottom, the name Black Bottom. Very quickly, the story of Nancy Ann Wiley. Nancy Ann Wiley was the slave woman because what a lot of people don't realize, especially if you don't know that Detroit had slaves, that half the slaves in the Detroit area were women.
Okay, no, I didn't know that.
Yeah, hey, and why would they have women? Mm-hmm. It's because their European women wouldn't come with them.
Okay.
All right. So they had to have women because not only are women nice to look at, but also we do things that men don't do. And we do some things better than what men do.
Thank God.
Thank God. And also some people always getting into the sex thing, and that probably did take place. But anyhow, getting back to our story. So Nancy Ann Wiley, she was an enslaved woman here. She worked for a man named Abbott. I do believe there is a street down by the Detroit River called Abbott. And that's where his store was, on Abbott. And anyhow, she was one of those what they call saltwater Africans.
Okay.
Saltwater Africans are the people who came directly from Africa, wasn't born here in the U.S. And I do believe that she held on to her African ways. And I do believe that she must have brought something from Africa with her that was very dear to her. And I think she kept it in something. Maybe it was a juju bag around her neck. Maybe it was something she kept in her pocket. Whatever it was, Abbott took it.
Okay.
And she wanted it back.
Okay.
So anyhow, as the story goes, she got a soldier, a French soldier, who maybe was her lover, maybe was just a friend, maybe he was just a nice guy, but she talked him into helping her break into Abbott's store to get whatever it was she wanted back. And while they were in the store caught on fire. And that was a sin in the old Detroit because most of the buildings were wood. So if one building caught on fire, the whole place could go up.
Right.
And so both she and this French guy were arrested. And they were supposedly tried. And their trial ended with the death sentence. So I said, okay. Everybody was all excited because you know how trials are. We know OJ and every other trial, everybody gets all excited and kill them, kill them, kill them, you know. And then it came time for the execution day, and the people decided that nobody really wanted to be the executioner, especially to kill the white guy. So somebody came up with this great little plan, and they told Ann Wiley that she killed him, that she could have her freedom.
Okay.
She killed him. And then after she killed him, they arrested her.
For murder.
For murder. So Ann Wiley realized that she had been tricked. And girlfriend was not happy. And she started twirling. And she started cursing in her native tongue. And these white folks who were there, oh, what is this woman doing? Oh, my God. Because they knew they were wrong. They knew they were wrong. So anyhow, she twirled and she twirled and she cursed and she whatever. And she was a spectacle and twirling and twirling and twirling and twirling. And then all of a sudden, she dropped dead right on the ground. face down. And that's where they started piling rocks up on her. They didn't even bury her. They didn't move her. They thought that she had cursed, and they said that she had cursed Detroit for what they did wrong to her.
Mm-hmm.
And they piled these rocks on her.
Mm-hmm.
And would you believe that's where she stayed until they started making the streets of Detroit, and they found her body still there under the rocks, face down.
Wow.
So, was it Ann Wiley's Black Bottom that they called it Black Bottom?
Something to think about. Things that make you go,
Okay, then now there's another story. Remember, they kept saying it was the soil that was black.
Right.
Okay. Now, you know when Paradise Valley, do you know how Paradise Valley got its name?
You can tell us.
Okay, well, actually, the true way that Paradise Valley got its name was a newspaper contest to name the area. And basically, Paradise Valley was the entertainment district, mm-hmm. which, if you know where Ford Field is, that's where Paradise Valley was. And that's where the jazz clubs were back in the day. That's where some of the best black restaurants were. That's where the nightlife was. That's where white folks came to tap their feet.
I think they call it slumming, right? When they come into the black neighborhood.
They
were coming to the black neighborhood.
Well, they were coming. Party. You're right. The party.
They call it slumming.
Right. And so some people think that Paradise Valley was named after a certain part of a woman's body.
Oh, okay.
Because Paradise Valley was known for their very fabulous women.
Okay.
And some of these women would share themselves with a gentleman.
Okay.
So that was one thought as to how Paradise Valley got its name.
So it was a way to paradise, huh?
Right.
Okay.
So anyhow, those are little behind-the-scenes information that you won't find in your history books until we start writing our history.
And we need to do that. So what prompted you to do this? You said a little bit about being inspired by the people from the Underground Railroad, the escaped formerly enslaved people. But tell us a little more about the documentary, the story, the timeline. And also, I know that you're currently revising the work
We need to put Kilpatrick into our history of Detroit, especially in the black history.
Definitely.
We need to add him.
But you're also trying to revise it so that it fits the contemporary technology as well.
Oh, yeah, because technology continues to evolve so quickly that some of my DVDs don't play on the current DVDs and the what's the other one, the Bluetooth
Blu-ray
so all that technology.
Is it available somewhere?
Yes, I'm in the process of getting it redone. So if you would like to have a copy of Black Bottom and Paradise Valley, The Forgotten Legacy, get in touch with me or get in touch with you.
Tell the listening audience what I have to do while you do this, and this is probably not necessarily professional. I have to get the telephone and bring it here because I'm sure that people want to talk to you.
Oh.
So if you could just tell us how we...
I'll tell you how to get there.
Okay.
Okay. You can reach me on my, my email. And that is griotproductions@yahoo.com. And that's GRYOT. And then productions with an S at yahoo.com. And that's GRYOT again.
Okay.
Because I spelled griot a little differently than it's usually spelled.
Okay. And this is Sharon Sexton, the producer, writer, and everything. You're involved in every aspect of producing this documentary.
Yes.
And you're listening to Get Up, Stand Up. This is the Black in the Day in a 313 segment. We urge you to call in with any questions, comments, or suggestions that you may have.
Please do.
Now, give us an overview of how this documentary unfolds, if you can do that.
Well,
kind
of a
timeline.
It starts with the French. And everybody knows Cadillac founded Detroit. And I always say, how do you find something when people are already here? But according to the Europeans, He founded Detroit, and we came here, and I've had a debate whether or not he brought slaves with him, but the French were involved in enslaving black people.
Yes.
And if they didn't come with Cadillac on that first boat, they came with him eventually.
Yes.
And that's how black people got to the Detroit area, was
yes.
through the French and being brought here basically as enslaved people.
And that's very important, if I could interject, because a lot of times, and I think we're even losing this. I know growing up in Detroit, when I did, I had many friends that would go down south during the summertime on vacations. Many were going back because their grandparents were in the South, and most of us have roots in the South. And I say that to say, many times we hear that the presence of people of African descent in Detroit began with the migrations, but it's important that we know and understand. Of course, we know there's Ivan Van Sertima's, who I think it's before the Mayflower. Mm-hmm.
They came before Columbus.
Or before Columbus, yeah. I think it is. The other brother, was it Laurent Bennett, did before the Mayflower. Anyhow, he documents the presence of Africans in the quote-unquote New World. But coming up to more contemporary time, we know that the French, the British, and all these other entities were involved in the transatlantic slave trade and the colonization of the New World. And we know part of the whole process of enslaving, the purpose for enslaving Africans is because they did not want to do the work. And we know if they came here and there was work that had to be done and they had access to the free labor of enslaved Africans, that there were Africans that came here with them.
Right.
So I'm just saying, it's an important part of history that we need to know. So I'm just saying.
It's not in the history
important.
Books.
Exactly.
Yeah, they don't say, hey, Cadillac brought some slaves with him. No,
right.
They don't say that. They just kind of. And in fact, I don't even know if they would have even recorded who those individuals were. Because don't forget, it was chattel, you know, it was kind of like a bag, you know, bringing a bag, bringing
right.
your hairdresser, you know, who, whatever. So
one way it was different, because they really didn't have plantations here.
No.
Detroit was a major place for trapping and furring.
Yeah, it's a wilderness.
So in a lot of cases, it would be fewer captured Africans traveling with the French because of the type. They weren't really getting into cultivating the land and all that. You had people coming through trapping, catching beavers and dealing with furs and things
Detroit
like that.
Detroit was a pretty dismal place.
Yes.
Nobody really wanted to be here unless you were born here, kind of the same as we have today.
If the weather had anything
well,
to
let
do
me
with
tell
it.
You something very fascinating that I heard somewhat recently when I was watching PBS, that's public television, and that's, you know, they were up in the UP,
mm-hmm.
or wherever they have the sand dunes, and at one time they had the copper mines, mines from the Indians.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you know, wherever that is up there.
Right.
But
I don't know if it's in the UP, but I know it's north of here. Right.
In the upper part of the lower peninsula or up in the upper peninsula. But anyhow, wherever this place is, they had these copper mines.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, interesting to hear that in Africa, they found some ancient African people. They had copper. The copper was from Michigan.
Wow. So what does that tell us?
So that tells us that there was already contact between at least Michigan and Africa back a long time ago.
And it's interesting that you say that. Not only was there contact, but there had to be travel.
Trade.
Two-way travel. Trade. Exactly, that's what I was going to say. But I was in a workshop once on, colonial / period of enslavement in the Americas. And there was a scholar that came in and talked about how they had done research that showed that certain Egyptian pharaohs that had been mummified, they had exhumed their DNA and found that they had cocaine. They had been
right.
ingesting cocaine
from South America.
Exactly. And it was funny because in the workshop, and it was a teacher's workshop, and this was held by the National Endowment of the Humanities. They had about 30 teachers there. Maybe 8 of us were black. So a couple of people immediately reacted like, okay, so now y'all trying to say the pharaohs were taking coke, right? But the real deal, what the scholar really was trying to emphasize, and I thought this was invaluable to us, is, as you said, that this documented that there's this travel and trade had occurred between South America and ancient Egypt.
Right.
And again, that's valuable information because we know that we're historically told that Egypt, that Africa did very little prior to 1619, and that Egypt is separate from Africa. But we know, as I mentioned earlier, Ivan Van Sertima documents, as well as other scholars, that Africa had a very advanced civilization spanning all the way back to ancient Egypt. But let's get back to
Black Bottom your story. And Paradise.
That's
really?
Right. That's right. Because remember, this show is Black in the Day in the 313.
But then, too, you can see how with all this experience, you know, and all this different being here in this area where people were able to, I guess, thrive with is the word I'm looking for. How the black people here were a whole, I mean, we're a different breed around Detroit than almost any place else in the country. And I do believe it's because of this long history of freedom and free thinking and being innovative and creative and doing what they needed to do. And the thing, too, there's an incident dealing with the Blackburn family, and I'm not going to go into all this.
You must have read my mind, because I was just thinking about the Blackburns. And Baba Jamin has been here, and he talked about it. We talked about it.
So I don't need to go.
Go ahead.
Well, the Blackburns, back in 1833, they had run away from Kentucky, and they had come to Detroit because they had heard that this is free for black people. And while they were here, they were found out. And again, very personal, the slave owner decides he's going to come and get them back. Mm-hmm. And the black community galvanized and basically had an uprising, more or less, and were able to free the Blackburns. The Blackburns escaped over to Canada, and the Canadians actually didn't know what to do with them. And that was the beginning, because they had to go through the court system. And the Canadian courts decided that they did not recognize slavery because the British Empire had just ended slavery within their
empire.
Yes.
Colonies.
Yeah. And so Canada no longer had slaves. Mm-hmm. And so when the Blackburns went over there, Canada courts said that they did not recognize slavery. So they did not send the Blackburns back into slavery. And that was basically the beginning of African-American enslaved people escaping to Canada for freedom. Mm-hmm. So that's it in a nutshell. Okay, now I forgot what I was going to... But... And now I forgot what it was that I was going to.
But the Blackburns is a very we were just kind of talking, kind of asking for a chronological account of the story.
I know what I said. Okay, I remember. Okay, when the Blackburns got over to Canada, the white people here in Detroit rounded up the entire black community, and basically for 5 years after that, they would not trade and or talk to black people in this community.
Mm-hmm.
So the blacks, basically, they, again, galvanized. They traded with one another. They traded with the Native Americans and the white people who were able to who ignored the basic order of not dealing with the black people, and they survived. And they became a very strong force, and it was those individuals who came together to found this African American Mysteries, the Order of the Men of Oppression, and were geniuses.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so like I said, it's that spirit in Detroit that I don't think that people, I don't even think we understand what it is, but we just know that we're not going to take no stuff off of nobody for no reason, and we will fight for our rights.
Right. So talk to us a little more. Do you address the African American mystery systems in your documentary?
A little bit. Like I said, my documentary just kind of puts things in chronological order.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't get deep into almost anything. It just kind of like lets you know what happened. Mm-hmm. It might, you know, give you a little example of what was going on, but it doesn't really get into it deep as far as I would like to get into it, which is so
but it would be a good introduction.
Yeah, maybe, it's an introduction
for Black history in Detroit. And another thing that I think gets overlooked in DPS and probably throughout Michigan public schools, some of the Michigan state standards benchmarks for the state curriculum requires
I'm not an educator like that.
Anyhow, curriculum, that's not the word I was looking for, but curriculum that deals with, or aspects of the curriculum that deals with different personalities in Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the perfect opportunity. Documentaries like yours and other resources and some of the history we're talking about for us to tell those stories. A lot of people don't know that Sojourner Truth had a home here, not in Detroit, but I think it was in Battle Creek.
It was in Battle, but you know, Sojourner Truth too. She used to support the Black troops, the 102nd mm-hmm. Colored Troops Infantry, who were training over at Camp Ward, which is right between Elmwood Cemetery and what used to be Duffield Elementary School. I think that's been renamed Middle School. Ralph, mm-hmm. yeah. But anyhow, she used to come down regularly and support the troops.
Mm-hmm.
So she was in Detroit quite a bit. And did you know that on the Civil War Monument, which is in Campus Martius downtown, the woman facing east with a little baggy thing on her head, that was supposed to be in the spirit of Sojourner Truth.
I didn't know that.
I just come and bring you all kinds of information.
And we appreciate it. This is Black in the Day in the 313.
And so that's why I have to get all this stuff out of my head, because I've seen my own mortality. I got hit by a car last year.
I remember you saying that. And you were riding your bike.
I was riding my bicycle, and somebody made a left-hand turn and tried to run over me, literally. Killed my bicycle. But it was then I realized that, hey, I can't just have all this stuff in my head and just come and talk to people about it. I have to, you know, put it down there so that if something really does happen to me, the information is out there. So that's why I'm going to start writing it up.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully you'll be supportive in telling your children and reading the books, because I am writing a children's book on the Blackburn Affair. Because I really think that just like children know everything about Harriet Tubman,
mm-hmm.
they need to know about the Blackburns and what happened here in Detroit, and really the beginning of the Underground Railroad as we now remember it.
Oh, it's so many phenomenal stories. Even if we move forward, Ocean Sweet, what's the gentleman's name? Snow Grigsby, Barry Gordy Sr. with his grocery store.
These are contemporary people, not Underground Railroad folks.
No. But I'm saying there's such a legacy of people of African descent exercising agency and building community in Detroit. And, you know, I had an interesting event occur once this past school year. I was at my son's school. He was in the sixth grade at the time, and I was reading Coleman Young's book, Hard Stuff. And, you know, in the book, he has a baseball hat on, and he's throwing out the first pitch. And this young man, maybe in the fourth or fifth grade, said, well, who is this athlete? And I was just amazed that school grade age children don't know who Coleman Young is. And I think that's a crime, because...
Wait. Let me make sure I understand you. You're saying that school age children in Detroit today do not know who Coleman Young is?
Well, this was one case. The young man said, who is he? Is he a baseball player? And I said, well, this is Coleman Young. You don't know who Coleman Young is? No, I don't know who that is. And it's so interesting because to me, and, you know, I was a teenager when Coleman Young got elected. But we all know that Coleman Young had such a strong representation and legacy with African-American men in his community. I mean, he was like the quintessential man. Mm-hmm. And that is important because our young men and women need to know that there were men like Coleman Young.
And there are still men like Coleman Young. We just have to have them come to the surface and come out from under wherever they're hiding, because we need real leadership in this city right now. Real
this is true.
Black for black leadership in this city. And which we have not had for quite a while.
That's true.
Probably since Coleman Young.
I was in at the rally that Minister Malik Shabazz mentioned yesterday at 6 Mile in Gratiot, where a young lady went into this. We were rallying there. This didn't happen yesterday, but she was going into the Metro PCS store to pay her phone bill. And a brother grabbed her and pulled her out of the store and trying to, I guess, hit on her or accost her. And he wound up actually assaulting her, beating her.
Excuse me?
I think some brothers in the community, along with the police, found her, and this gentleman was arrested. But I'm just saying there were some men there at the rally urging other men to stand up and be men. Even when we walked into the studio, Minister Malik was talking about how it wouldn't be safe for you to go out to the corner store at this hour by yourself. You might be able to do it in your own neighborhood.
I take Bear with me.
Okay. But you should be able to walk through your community and feel safe. Based on the fact that there's men out there. But we know that that's not the kind of community that we live in. But we do need those kind of men. And the same type of men that DeBaptiste was, that William Lambert was, and Henry Bibb and others who acted like men and acted to liberate enslaved African men and women and help them find a safe haven and help them be able to build and create new lives for themselves.
And not only that, I guess, you know, people really don't understand what those men did back in the day, because they were also the ones who came up with the concept of the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments.
No, I didn't know that.
Well, that's why I'm here to tell you.
But wait, we came up with amendments like that, but we were supposed to be inferior, ignorant, savage,
don't forget that
couldn't read and couldn't write.
But that's not what it was here in Detroit. Don't forget we had a core of people who were literate.
Mm-hmm.
And who were imaginative, and they had means. Plus, what they didn't have, they also, there were white people in the city of Detroit who were very wealthy at the time, and who financed quite a bit of the Underground Railroad activities. Mm-hmm. And some people said, well, why did they have the African American Mysteries? And it's like, well, because the anti-slavery society in Detroit didn't allow black members.
And you know, that's fascinating, the small research that I've done on the African American Mysteries. They had an order that they didn't allow the white abolitionists to be a part of. Did you know that?
Oh yeah.
And they also had an armed faction where they carried guns on the Underground Railroad.
Oh, they paraded right up in front of Second Baptist Church with their guns.
But see, they don't tell us that. They tell us that Harriet Tubman made 19 trips, not to take anything away from Harriet, and we know that she was armed.
Yeah, I love Harriet Tubman because she started me into reading about the Underground Railroad when I was in seventh grade.
And she was armed.
She was armed.
She was armed. But we don't hear the stories about the men that we mentioned and how they created this secret society of black men
and women.
Thank you for correcting me.
And women.
Who would only allow others to become so involved because they didn't trust them, because of entities like the anti-slavery society and things like that.
And then, too, you know, like John Brown. Everybody,
John Brown. You saw it in my head. Brown, I was ready to mention Brown. John
okay.
Brown.
Do you know who John Brown is? John Brown's body lays this morning. Okay, but anyway. John Brown was an abolitionist who...
Yes.
Harper's Ferry. He was a white abolitionist. But before he did what he did at Harper's Ferry, he came and met with the brothers here in Detroit.
Yes.
And the brothers in Detroit told him, don't do it. It's not going to work. But did he listen? No. He went and did what he did anyway. And of course, the Detroit and the Detroit Chatham, which is over in Canada, the coalition, they did send two reps, a black man and a white man, and would you believe those are the only two who survived?
Mm. You know, he was involved in another attempt similar to Harper's Ferry. I forget the year, but it was in Potawatomi.
Yeah.
I can't remember the state that it was in, but I think he lost one or two.
Wasn't that in Wisconsin?
I'm not sure, but I think maybe one or two of his sons were killed or in prison as a result of that. But that's the kind of white abolitionist I like, because John Brown was about it.
Okay. I'll tell you why.
Tell me why.
Because John Brown had decided that once he had this revolution for black people, he was going to set himself up as the president.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, okay. That's why I said you know.
That's probably why he didn't succeed.
Yeah, that's probably why the brothers here in Detroit had an issue with some of the things he did.
Okay.
Okay? Because he wanted to be their boss.
He wanted to be the overseer. He wanted to be the new master.
Boss. He wanted to be the president of the new black country.
So tell us more.
Because I don't remember these things just to tell them. People, you know, get me in conversation.
Your documentary, so it begins 300 years ago.
Right.
And what were some more contemporary, say, post the African mystery systems, or do you come into what we call contemporary
time?
Up to the migration periods of the early 1900s?
Yes.
You know, there were two migrations, one around World War I and then one around World War II.
Well, you know, too, what has been left out of history books. I am sweating like.
I wish I had grabbed some paper towel.
Yeah, that's okay. But when we talk about this migration, we always think about the black migration from the south to the north.
Mm-hmm.
What is always not mentioned is the white migration from the south to the north during these same times, and even from after the Civil War.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, as we think of Detroit, we always think of Detroit being north and northern and on the Yankee side during the Civil War and go, you know, anti-slavery, go pro-black people. No. First of all, about half the city was, just like the Republicans and Democrats now, half and half, you know, white folks are always, you know, fighting politically and all that kind of stuff. So when the Southerners from down south, the white Southerners started coming in, then all of a sudden, the more racist part of Detroit started becoming more predominant.
Mm-hmm.
And there were more white folks coming up from the south and there were black people.
Mm-hmm.
So by the 1920s, Detroit had at least half of its white population was from the south. Oh, thank you. Was from the south. So that's one reason why, you know, and I don't think people even realize that the Klan used to march down Woodward Avenue. People, you know, like nowadays, they don't even think that the Klan was in Detroit.
Right.
And the Klan is very much in Detroit.
And, you know, at one point, this was the seat of the Klan. Over 30,000, they boasted to have a 30,000 member population, a Klan member.
Mm-hmm.
And there was an emergent organization called the Black Legion that emerged out of the Klan because the Klan viewed them to be too radical. So they got pushed out of the Klan, and this was the Black Legion, And I'm reading a book now, and there's a couple other books where I've seen references to the Black Legion. The book is called Terror in the City of Champions. It's by a gentleman named Tom Stanton, who writes about baseball. But what he's done, and I think it's kind of interesting, I'm not necessarily a big baseball fan, but there's a subtitle, race something in the Depression era.
Okay.
But he intertwines this story about the Black Legion with what was happening with baseball in Detroit during the late 20s and 30s. And he gets into, he does some real good documentation of the Black Legion. Charles Bowles, who was one of Detroit mayors in the 1930s, was elected. He was strongly supported by the Klan and thought to have had been a member of the Klan, gets elected in either 30, 32, or 34. Now, he's not able to complete his term in office because of corruption, but he's strongly supported by the Klan. And around the same time, and I forget the mayor's name, but the mayor of Highland Park was an avowed Klan member and supported by the Black Legion. So, and this Black Legion, they met on a regular basis. They had all kind of secret rituals and different things they did to get people to swear to commit their lives to the perpetuation of what they called Americanism, which was white supremacy. And they were anti-Jew, anti-Semitic, anti-Jewish, anti-Catholic. There was a father, his name was Father Coughlin, I might be saying his name slightly wrong, who was the head priest, I think, at the, I think it's called the Shrine of the Little Flower, which is on Woodward, up near 12 Mile. He had a radio show with millions of followers where he got on the radio show and preached white supremacy and all of this. And all of this was going down in Detroit. And part of what this was about, and it's interesting because the rhetoric is so reminiscent of what we're hearing today,
right,
about let's make America great again. We're going to take our country back. And these people, these Klan members, and they, in this book, I'm not even halfway through the book, you had these former Klansmen and Klansmen carrying out hits on newspaper men, different public officials who didn't vote the way they wanted them to vote. And it's so reminiscent of what we're hearing and what I associate with all of the sentiment that seems to be rallying around Donald Trump. So this could be a resurgence, if you will, of the same sentiment that we know was prevalent leading up to the Civil War, that persisted after the Civil War had ended, because there's people still today, white people today, who are pissed that they lost the Civil War. And interestingly,
you know, they didn't lose it.
Okay.
From PBS, but you know, watching a documentary dealing with General Lee. He never told his troops they lost the war.
Really?
No.
I didn't know.
He went back and told them they had more men or something to that effect. But he never said, we lost, we surrendered, none of that. It was just kind of like they just had more men.
Mm-hmm.
So in the minds of the Confederate, they never lost the war.
And we know the period immediately following the Civil War was called Reconstruction, which was a period that was, we have a caller calling, so I stopped there and let's see what our caller has to say. Good evening and welcome to Get Up, Stand Up. Tell us your name and a quick comment or question, please.
Good evening, Dr. Chike, and to your guests.
How are you?
I'm fine. This is Sister Keela.
Welcome to the show.
Yes. I just want to say I was listening to the program and listening to the two of you get the history of Detroit. Really should be a required subject in Detroit public schools. I listened to you talk about how a young child didn't know who Colin Young is. And one of the things that I think is missing is a knowledge of our history.
Yes.
And the history of Detroit is a good place to start. But I just wanted to make that comment, is that we need more history in our schools, in our classrooms. And I know you're down on time, but maybe next week we'll talk about GPS. I left a meeting today where they are, they have just really destroyed the district.
Well,
but
we have to bring.
We need to talk, when, you know, like I said, listening to you talk and listen to you to talk about the history, we need more conversation. I think not only do our children need it, the adults need it.
That's true. And a lot of times what I found as an African-centered educator, and we have another caller. We see you, caller. We're going to get to you soon. Is when you teach the children, a lot of times when you teach children things that their parents don't know, the parents wind up learning the things by default.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So we appreciate you calling, and of course, hopefully, prayerfully, when we get you reelected as to the school board, we can make that happen.
Sounds great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, good night. Good evening, caller. You listening to Get Up, Stand Up. This is the Black in the Day segment. Could you tell us your name and a quick comment or question, please?
Hi, Dr. Kofense. This is Danny. I just wanted to call in and tell you how much we appreciate you and your knowledge. And First Lady Akila is absolutely correct. We need more history teaching, especially for some of us adults as well. So.
And I appreciate you. I noticed that my forehead is shining, so.
Here's that.
No, I said that because she's the makeup lady, so. But we appreciate you as well, and it was good seeing you at the rally yesterday, and thank you for listening and calling.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Till next time.
All right. Take care.
Bye-bye.
All right. We got about 2 or 3 minutes left.
Okay, but, you know, since we're talking and you get me to remember all these things.
That means we're going to have to do a part two follow-up.
But what's frightening to me as a historian, especially being knowledgeable about the Underground Railroad and Reconstruction and everything, what we're looking at right now is almost the same thing that we went through Reconstruction. And you know what happened that ended Reconstruction was Jim Crow.
Yep. Well, it was a couple of things. Jim Crow was the next phase of Reconstruction. It was a response to Reconstruction, but also there was a deal made, the Hayes-Tilton sellout, where the Republicans, who were supposed to be saving us or helping us segue into society, made a deal to allow their presidential candidate to sit. Now, we don't really have enough time to go into it now.
But if you go back and read what happened to Reconstruction and look at what's happening now,
mm-hmm.
it's very frightening that it's almost the same path.
And there's historians, the African-American historians, who have actually made that same analogy,
yeah.
that we're propelling ourselves backwards as did the end of Reconstruction, which led to, it thwarted a lot of success, because coming out of the era of enslavement during Reconstruction, you had the mass movement of black people into the society. Hundreds of African Americans were elected to offices. We built businesses. We took different positions in the government.
Because
and all of that was undone.
Yeah.
So, do you have any closing comments for us?
Well, I just appreciate you letting me come in here and talk. And you encouraged me to go ahead and put all this stuff in writing, because we really need to educate not only the children, but their parents, because, you know, the kids aren't getting the information because the teachers don't know.
And
so.
Well, but see, here's the thing. As I said, the state makes provisions for this. They don't say black Americans or black Michiganders, but those of us that are in the classroom should take it upon ourselves to do this. So we appreciate you coming in.
Okay.
I'm going to ask you to commit in front of our audience to come back for a follow-up.
Well, if you can deal with my rambling about black history, then I will be back to ramble more.
It's been great, and we appreciate you. We have Sharon Sexton here. My name is Kofense Chike. You've been watching Get Up, Stand Up with Minister Malik Shabazz. This is the Black in the Day segment, Black in the Day in the 313, and we urge you to get up, stand up. Make sure you go out and vote tomorrow. We're in, and to go out and vote tomorrow And we'll see you the same time next week. Get up, stand up.
And power to the people.